Hi, everybody. I feel like I know all of you, but there's some of you I don't know. As you know lovingly, I call you the shirts, and call yourself the shirts. Actually, that was a nice introduction, and it actually, I thought this morning, I got up this morning and I went like, what am I going to tell these people? They know, they know what they want to do. They know what they want to get done. For me to tell them, to tell you what I need to tell you, I can do that in about 60 seconds. And so I decided rather than waste all this time, I decided that I would talk about me. And so I was born in Amarillo, Texas, 1949. It's windy up there. And there's also good music that comes out of the. I grew up with Buddy Holly and the Flatlanders, and by the time I was 13, I had a really good rock and roll band. By the time I was 15, I had a really good rock and roll band. So part of my personality is because I used to stand up in front of people and play music. I had a pretty good band. We kind of traveled regionally, and so that kind of developed my personality. And then I went to University of Texas, and before I started off in engineering as an aerospace engineer, and then my brother said, that's just too much work. Why don't you just go over to the business school and it won't be nearly as hard? And he was right, it wasn't nearly as hard. And so I went over there and did business and marketing. And before I got out of the school, I started my own advertising agency called Directions Company. And Directions Company, I'm now like 22 years old, and I went out and picked up, some accounts. I got Pants South, which is about a chain of 30 or 40 pants. That was back when everybody bought, there were pants stores. And I picked up the University Co-op, so that was my big department store. And then I picked up Armadillo World Headquarters, as well as a bunch of other places. But the Armadillo obviously was clearly the most fun of all that. And there was one probably year and a half or 2 year period where, if I include promoting midnight movies, which I rented the Varsity Theater as a 22-year-old every Friday and Saturday night, and ran midnight movies at midnight. And it was the guy I made the deal with. I don't know if he ever even told the owners of the theater chain what we were doing, but I was paying him $200 a night for the theater and charging about $2 a ticket. And every now and then I get 1,200 people in there. And so that was, I was rocking and rolling. And so having a great time. And then something changed in me. It was, I was selling pants, and I was selling concert tickets, selling music, And I thought, I don't know if I'm going to do this all my life. And Comet Kahutek, anybody remember Comet Kahutek? It was supposed to be this really big deal. This is now 1973, so I'm about 24 years old. And Comet Kahutek was coming through, and I got really intensely interested in Comet Kahutek. And so interested in it that I actually booked, got a ticket to go from San Antonio to El Paso, knowing that the train would stop in Alpine, Texas at 3 in the morning, and the Comet would be in exactly the perfect spot, and I would get off the train in Alpine, Texas, and I would see Comet Kahutek. So I did that, and I got off the train, and by golly, there it was, just like I'd figured out. And it was so disappointing, because everybody thought that Comet Kahutek was going to be this great comet, and of course it was. You could just barely find it. You had to go out into the deserts to find it. And I decided at that point that I would start doing something other than pushing rock and roll and pushing jeans and pushing consumer society. And so I started building passive solar homes. And the first house I built was based on the design of an old Texas ice house. It was halfway in the ground, and I actually got the books out on how they built ice houses, and I just really built this guy an ice house and said, it's Texas, an ice house ought to be as good as any. And it's been 44 years now, and that guy's still living in that house. It's, I don't know how happy he is. He never did get married. But that kind of started me in the solar business, and I read and read and read and read. I read every book. I read every solar book. I read every book there was. Because I had dadgum Bucky Fuller, you know, his Utopia or Oblivion book was just, you know, in my head. You know, I'm just like, well, we just can't go on the way we're living because we're not going to live very long if we go on the way we're living. And so, you know, Utopia or Oblivion was like, why have you read this book? You know, it's like this Bucky Fuller guy, you know, it's like, you know, the guy that did the dome and all this other stuff. And I got myself in the, this was 76 now, and Jimmy Carter had passed the Public Utility Regulatory Policy Act of 76, and that opened up the electric markets to, quote, people who wanted to produce energy. They were called qualifying facilities, and I got appointed by the governor to be on the committee that wrote the rules for that. And you probably all don't know, but for many, many years, Texas had one of the most progressive net meter billing rules, and it was actually just a rule for qualifying facilities for if you had a small windmill or solar or whatever like that. Under PURPA, I had gone into a room about like this, and I sat down because I was trying to go to the small scale producers meeting, and I realized that I was in the wrong room. And I thought, well, I can't just get up and leave. Then everybody will know I'm a dumbbell. And so then the administrative law judge says, now does anybody have any language on section 11.9-.8? And I said, what is that? And she said, well, that's the section on how large a qualifying facility can be in order to basically net meter. You know, and I said, well, yeah, I've got an idea. Let's make it 50 kilowatt hours. I mean, make it 50 kW. And she said, well, all right, Mr. Osborne, would you go out and write that down and bring it back? And I went out and got to the, this is how long ago this was. I got to the phone booth and called Russell Smith of the Texas Renewable. At the time, we weren't in Texas Renewable. It was still Texas, which was Texas Solar Energy Site. I called him. I said, I think we just got a 50 kW net billing rule through. And he said, how'd you do it? And I said, I went in the wrong room. So then I became a SolarX distributor. And I, at that time, no, solar was so expensive. It was like 50 cents a kilowatt hour. And so I, you know, but I sold the little panels to like the gate guys, you know, to open the gates and keep the gate chargers working. And I sold them I sold them a lot to the railroads, you know, you see them on the sides of the railroads. And I did that. And then at the same time, about the same time, I put in the first commercial wind farm in Texas. Because I knew all about PURPA, so I became the first person to ever actually sell electricity, you know, into the grid with my five wind turbines that I put up in 1981, and that was fun. And at the same time, I started a magazine called Spectra, which was this really beautiful, perfect bound white magazine. I was going to bring one, but I forgot it. And it was the official publication of the Texas Solar Energy Society. And it was pretty cool, but I folded that thing in about a year and a half because I wasn't shooting money out in cannons, but I was shooting money out, you know, with an AR-15 or something. It was going out fast, and so I cut that because it obviously wasn't quite time. Plus Reagan had come in, and everything was changing. Reagan had taken the Jimmy Carter's solar panels off, and so it looked like, ooh, we're going through a dip here. So we started TREA, the Texas Renewable Energy Industry Association, Russell and I did, and another guy named Warren Cole, who manufactured solar panels here in Austin, you know, for many, many years, and he's sort of a forgotten person, but he's a real hero in the solar business. And we started TREA. It's been around now for 30-something years. I began wind leasing for Zond, which was this wind company that I aligned with early on. And so I started going out to West Texas, and I started putting up monitors in West Texas and finding out where the winds were, and actually going out and beginning to take leases, because I was really by that time running the operations for Zond, and then Zond turned into Enron, which turned into General Electric, and I stayed with them all through that time. And then when they went to General Electric, then that's when I went to Austin Energy. And during that time, I wrote this book, Lightland, Climate Change and the Human Potential. And I just wanted to read out of this because it's spooky how things have not changed. This is this was based as a springboard to write about climate change. I based this on the Theogony, which was a classic work by Hesiod. And the Theogony is about this great battle that occurs between the Titans and the Olympians. And so there's a whole big long poem called the Titanomachy. This is towards the end of the book, and I go, the Vice President of the United States, Al Gore, writes in his book, Earth in Balance, so that was like his first book, you know, and a new common purpose. It says, whether we realize it or not, we are now engaged in an epic battle to right the balance of the earth, and the tide of this battle will turn only when the majority of the people in this world become sufficiently aroused by a shared sense of urgent danger to join in an all-out effort. He wrote that like 25 or 30 years ago. I went on to say, given that the coal and petrochemical lobbies have been so successful at blunting and perverting the clear and present dangers of the continuation of the burning of fossil fuels, it can be imagined that public opinion will not be aroused until the evidence is truly unassailable. The evidence will reveal itself in the continuation of scientific records indicating the warming of our waters and of our air. It will reveal itself in records of continued rising sea levels. There will be more announcements of temperature rises in the Arctic and the Antarctic. There will be announcements of large breakups of ice. There will be studies indicating the tundra is moving on and on and on and on and on. This was written in 1999, so this is about 20 years old. And there's some prophecies in here, but it basically, you know, I said then that we're not going to do what we need to do, and there's a reason for that, and that's what I'm going to get to in a minute after I quit talking about myself. But so I went to Austin Energy, I did the Community of the Future initiative, and wrote this book called Silver in the Mine, which. I don't know, 10,000-15,000 copies of it went out. A lot of people looked at it, and it was a lot of fun. At the same time, you know, Roger Duncan and I started the plug-in hybrid program, where we got 10,000 orders and worked with General Motors, and I wrote the memo that said, you know, what we want is a car that goes about 50 miles. And then the generator, the onboard generator kicks on, and they went, oh, okay, you know, because 80% of all trips are less than 40 miles, so let's build an electric car that can get 80%, because I'm a big believer in the 80-20 rule, which, you know, there's a book out on that, but, you know, you can get 80% of something done with 20% of the effort if you do it the right way, and the last 20%, you know, takes 80% of the effort. So Roger and I did that, and lo and behold, we ended up with a Volt, and there were several out there tonight that I saw. I joined Mayor Adler and County Commissioner, I talked him into going, with County Commissioner Shea and with City Council Member, who was it that went with us? I'll think of it in a minute. And we went to Paris for the... And we went up to the Eiffel Tower and signed the document, the C-40 document, and had hors d'oeuvres. It was Leslie Poole, yeah. And with hors d'oeuvres, you know, with the new mayor from Paris. There's another book called The Great Texas Wind Rush, in which a New York Times writer found me to be the most colorful And so they wrote this book called The Texas Wind Rush. It was Kate Galbraith and Asher Price from The Statesman wrote it. And they kind of used me as a character because when I was a very, very young man, actually I just set up for the band up, my rock and roll band up, and we were pretty young and we had about an hour to kill. And I went out and we bought 2 10-cent gliders, you know, those little balsa wood gliders. And this is a true story. I promise this is not a Texas tall tale.